Hello and welcome everyone in the another class of Pune Study Circle. Dear students, now we are going to learn about administrative management theory, or we are going to learn about the proponent of administrative management theory, that is Henry Fayol. We have had two classical thinkers. The first one was father of scientific management, Mr. Frederick Winslow Taylor, and second one was Henry Fayol. Henry Fayol is known as father of administrative management. Whenever we are learning about a theory, we must be clear about the perspective of the proponent, his contributions, and how he bear differences from the other contemporary thinkers. Here we are studying about Henry Fayol. You know what? Henry Fayol was a coal mine engineer. He began his career as a functional manager. He was born in 1841 and he died in 1925. And he is the man, if you have read his book, if you got a chance to read his book, he has nothing left what he learned over 84 years. This is a long period. This is a long span of learning. It means if you learn these principles which were propounded by him, which were prescribed to us or to all the managers across the world by him, then you will be a full-fledged manager. His book, which was titled as Journal and Industrial Management, is still working like a loud lighthouse that is to be followed by all the management practitioners. Guys, he had some differences from Frederick Winslow Taylor. The first difference was that he viewed organization from structural point of view, whereas Frederick Winslow Taylor viewed organizations from the work perspective. Frederick Winslow Taylor wanted to make effort to improve the efficiency of individual worker, but Henry Fayol was concerned about improving the productivity of organization as a whole. What Henry Fayol thought, he was more particular, he was more concerned about the relationship and behavior of manager at work site. He said, principle of management should have a comprehensive, a broad perspective. They are not only, or they should not only helpful to the operational manager, but they should extend equal help to the functional and strategic manager. Whereas the main criticism for Frederick Winslow Taylor principles is that they are moreover applicable at the level of grassroots level management. That means they were meant for guidance to the supervisors, foremen, and whatever category of lower level or operational level managers we are having. Now, we should also be very familiar with the two main contributions made by Henry Fayol. He is the first man who separated functions and principles of management. He said, elements or functions are those activities which are performed by all managers, be they are top level manager, functional managers, or lower level manager. Whereas principles of management should not be only related to the work aspect, but they should also be related to the structural and behavioral aspect of the manager. These are two main contributions. He said, the principles of management must bear two qualities in them. Very first, the list should be short enough. It means it should not be boring. Only those principles should be recommended for guidance to the behavior and action and decision making which are more usable. It means this lost list can be increased or can be reduced, but we should keep it as short as possible. Second quality, he said, the management principles should be flexible enough to accommodate themselves according to the changing need of our economy, our society, our quality, and our corporate efficiencies. Now we are going to learn about the meaning and definition of management. You know what? Management is not very difficult concept. You can define in the way you want. You can say management is the team of all those intellectuals who are empowered in any organizations to make decisions to push organization towards its attainment of goal. That is called management. That intellectual manpower which is having authority to make decisions to push organization towards attainment of its goal, and that attainment should be efficient and effective enough, is called management. You may call it, it is a goal-oriented effort, it is a group effort, it is a goal-oriented process, it is a group of activities which is performed in a scientific and logical order. All that is called management. Simply, management is concerned with the making decisions which are more productive, which are more profitful to the organization. Now, definition. Whenever you are mentioning theory with the description, So you must put forward the word of that gentleman who is the propounder of that theory. So here I'm going to explain the main definition which is given by the Henry Fayol. He said, management is an art of getting work done through others, and those others must be behaving in formally organized group. That means a relationship pattern must be predefined. Who is superior, who are subordinate, who are going to be our colleagues, from whom we have to receive order and to whom we are to give instructions, to whom we are accountable, and who are those who are accountable to us. Communication pattern, relationship pattern, goal, role, conflict, everything is clear. Getting work done through that group is called management. Here he said, management principles are having some utilities for the managers. What are those utilities? What are those importances of management principles? Here we are having insight to the manager. It has been more than 3 centuries. We are having result of experiments. We are having simple observation of managers who spent 40, 50 years of their life thinking about the detail and particular aspect of manager behavior and action. If we are having a plethora of knowledge, a body of knowledge which is having scientific principles and concept, we will be more effective managers, because we are not going to repeat those problems which have been faced by the managers before us. We are going to have a new set of problems for ourselves, and whatever our learnings are going to be there, they will be furnished by us in the advanced literature. Then coming to the effective administration. Can you imagine what kind of administration is called effective administration? That administration or that man is called more rational, who learns from the mistake of other and who gain from the learnings of others. So we have to be like that manager, the manager who has been through literature. You know, it is the joke. That is why we are pursuing the MBA curriculum. That is why we are having specialization in different field. That the man, whatever he is pretending to be, must be clear with the entire literature or at max literature to fill it belongs to or he belongs to. So we will be having effective administration only when we are quite thorough with concept, principles, and whatever literature is available in that concerned field. Our decisions are going to be more effective, they are going to be more particular. Here we are having third feature, scientific decisions. When you will call me that such teachings are scientific, only when I am quite clear with each aspect of my work, with each impact of my personality on your behavior. So when our workers are trained, we have defined them each and element, the methods, different methods of doing the work, procedure to be followed. I think decisions made by them will be more scientific, will be more structural, will be more accountable. The next feature is that provide adaptability. You know what? The main problem being faced by the managers in modern time is the resistance to change. Present times are the times of change. The frequency and the pace of changes has increased manifold. Whenever we are giving effect to a change, or whenever we want to implement a change, for example, when commercial bank were computerized, there were many strikes, there were lockouts, there were breakdowns of the work. The managers who had been working for years were not finding themselves competent to operate on the computers. That's why government introduced voluntary retirement scheme. We assured them that we are going to have a training program. You are not going to lose your jobs. And if you have intensity, if you are having inclination to learn, you are going to be more productive, you are going to get promotion, and your job will be more certain and your future will be more certain. So here, we should make our organization structure adaptive, flexible. We should keep introducing changes so that it becomes the behavior of employees or workers to entertain change. Or if we are introducing a certain change, we must ensure them that this change is going to be in benefit of only yours, not only the organization. Then they fulfill social responsibility. You know what? Better decisions always lead to the better outcome. If we are having a better management, we will reduce the cost. We will generate the profit, and that profit will again utilize for expansion and diversification. That means more generation of employment, more creation of income, more expenditure, more demand, improvement in the standard of living, improvement in the infrastructure, be it social or economical. Finally, we kind of management thinkers, we are trainees, we are PhD scholars. So these management principles are offering us a foundation about which we can rethink we can find out their shortcomings and we can find out their application in the present times, even we can improve over them. So these all are the significance of principles, 14 principles propounded by Henry Fayol. Now we are going to discuss about each and one principle, how it is relevant to modern times, and what are those principles which were suggested by him to be followed by us in both aspect, in functional aspect, in decision making aspect, and in our behavioral aspect. So here we are having read, I'm going to read it for you. Specialization is also called division of labor. Authority and responsibility should be co-equal. Discipline must be prevalent in the organization. Unity of command must lead to the effective outcome and reduce to the confusion. Unity of command will always ascertain us achievement of goal. Subordination of individual to the group goals, it will make us harmonious organization. It will establish industrial peace. Fair remuneration, that is prevalent in the industry. Centralization and decentralization must be balanced in manner to have an effective centralization. That means required authority must be given to the concerned employees so that decision making speed and quality and confidence and motivation of employees keep increasing. We are having here scalar chain. That means authority must flow to bottom, responsibility must flow bottom to top, and communication may flow as devised by management itself. Then we are having order. It means everything must be at its place and there must be a place for everything, be it the man or machine. Having equity in treatment towards employees. No bias. Everything should be fair enough so that we can reduce absenteeism, we can reduce employees turnover, we can retain our most important asset with us for longer period. Here we are having stability of tenure. That means job security. Simply, if the job is sure, you will be more productive. If your job is not sure, you will keep thinking about it. Where I'm going to be next year? Where I'm going to be next month? Or what about tomorrow? Will they invite me at job tomorrow? Or will I need to search somewhere else? Here we are coming to the initiative. We must promote initiative on the part of workers because they are the real unit which are performing work again and again over the period of time. If they have some productive thinking, if they are having some productive method, some procedure, so we should invite them, we should even motivate them. If you bring us some innovation, if you will take initiative in decision making as and when it is required, so you will be motivated enough with both kind of incentive, financial and non-financial incentives. Here we are having Esprit de Corps. Since he was a French industrial manager, he said team spirit, Esprit de Corps. This is a French phrase which means team spirit. Team spirit must be prevalent in the organization. If we are having team spirit, we can achieve a big unattainable goal hitherto in no times with our full satisfaction. So dear student, this is about the name of principle. Now we are going to discuss them in detail. But before that, I must mention here criticism of administrative management theory, or you may call it criticism of classical management thinker. Dear student, classical management thinkers are criticized largely on the ground that they thought that workers or employees are emotional beings. That means they are machines, they are objects. You can make them work to do for you as longer time as you want from them. If you pay them, they will be made to work for you even for longer hours, 18 to 20 hours. Second thing, they consider only financial incentive. Non-financial incentive like recognition, applause, awards, promotion were not considered by them. So these are the two criticisms. And one thing you also remember, Mr. Frederick Winslow Taylor was hygiene conscious, working environment conscious, whereas Mr. Henry Fayol was structural conscious, he was relationship conscious. Now this is about each and every principle reported by Henry Fayol in detail. Let's come to the first principle, that is principle of specialization, also called division of labor. This principle states that the work should be divided into its smallest element so that the worker who is performing the same work again and again over the time can develop efficiency and effectiveness. Besides division of work into simplest element, we should also give consideration while assigning this work to the particular worker that the base of assignment must be the interest and ability of the worker concerned. If we assign work or unit of work to an employee according to his interest and his ability, he will experience job satisfaction, and if he is satisfied at his job, then he will be more productive. Second principle is co-equality of authority and responsibility. Whenever we are assigning a group of tasks to an individual, we must empower him with the quantum of authority that is required to make effective decision at the work. Only then we can consider the accountable, or we can blame him the work performed by him. Otherwise, he will always get easily escaped from the accountability. He will not be answerable unless or until we provide him with the required amount of authority that is required to make decisions related to the work assigned to him. The next principle is about discipline. Discipline is very simple. That means respect for authority, rules, and employment agreement that you are having with the particular organization. And you should have a gesture of respect, obedience towards your seniors. It will help us establishing harmonious relationship or industrial peace at the work site. Then we are having unity of command. Unity of command states that every employee in an organization must have a single officer or must have a single superior officer who is authorized to give him orders, and he will only be answerable towards that superior. He will not be the answerable to the superior of superior. Rather, he will be only answerable to the person who has assigned him work and who has given him authority, be it through the delegation or through the decentralization. Here we can understand it with the help of example. We are having three employees and we are having two superiors. A, B and C are employees and their superior are D and E. B is answerable to D only. A is answerable to D only, whereas E is having only one subordinate and C is answerable to the E only. Here, if we say that A and B are also answerable to the E besides their answerability towards the D, it will cause confusion in their mind that who is the superior, whose order is to be obeyed first, and whose order is to be given secondary preference. So it will cause our industrial peace, it will affect our industrial peace, it will spoil our relationship, it will generate confusion and conflict in our working environment. Then we are having unity of direction. Unity of direction state that a group of activities having single objective must have a single plan and a single supervisor in order to have profitable, fruit-bearing, effective and efficient result. For example, whatever activities are being performed by these workers are aimed at achieving the goal which is called F. So this group of activity having same objective must have a single plan and must have a single superior. Only then we will have fruitful result, we will have easy achievement of goals and minimum wastage of efforts. If we are having more than two intellectuals, call him H. Okay, so here we are going to have more than one plan. We are going to have more than two orders. It will cause wastage of effort, wastage of time, and disharmony or reduce our team spirit and loyalty among the employees or among subordinate towards their superiors. The next principle is that subordination of individual to group goals. You know what? Organization is a group of large many persons who have come together to attain a goal which is conducive even towards attainment of their individual goal. Whenever we are performing as an organization, whenever we are performing as a team, we must think, we must forget, or we must consider subordinate our personal goals to the organizational goals. We must see our attainment in the attainment of organization. Then we will be having more secure job tenure, we will have more fruitful relationship at the work site. Then we are having fair remuneration. What do we mean by fair remuneration? whether it is the amount of salary, wages, bonus, or it is the mechanism of deciding or coming to the amount of salary, wages, bonus, increment, etc. It must be fair enough and it must have consent of trade unions and workers' representatives so that they do not create any kind of resistance which we are going to give them in terms of their work benefit. Then we are having centralization and decentralization. Centralization can be defined as systematic and scientific reservation of power at few critical posts. That means whenever an employee has to make decision, he must ask to his superior or the person or superior or superior or anybody who has authority in the organization. In case delay in decision making, but there is an advantage of this centralization. In case our subordinates are not having good educational profile, they are having poor educational profile, their learnings are not very much good, they are just laborer. It is effective to have the centralization because whatever power we will give them to make decision, they will misutilize it or they will not be able to utilize it properly. Then decentralization means systematic and comprehensive sharing of power throughout the organization in order to make workers more able to make their decision whenever they are encountered with a situation. You know what? Henry Fayol said, neither there should be a complete centralization nor there should be a complete decentralization. Centralization will cause the problem of decision making, delay in decision making, and decentralization will cause problem of misuse of the authority. Instead, we should have an effective centralization which is more productive. That means authority should be given to those who have ability to exercise it and reduce the organizational wastage. So instead of complete centralization and decentralization, we must have effective centralization. It means authority must be shared with those who are capable to make fruitful decisions, who are capable to make the decisions more scientific and more relevant. Then we are coming to the scalar chain. Principle of scalar chain state that authority, responsibility and communication must move in a predetermined direction by the management. Authority should always or must flow from top to bottom. Responsibility should flow from bottom to top and communication may either flow top to bottom or bottom to top. It may not have any kind of parallel arrangement. What he thought, if we allow workers operating at same level to communicate with each other, they will cause gossip, they will cause wastage of time and it will strengthen their unionization. These were the time when trade unions were emerging. So in order to avoid any kind of resistance to change or in order to save the wastage of time, he prescribed this principle. But later on, he had a second thought. Whenever he was criticized by saying that this kind of scalar chain will cause delay in decision making and will affect or will make workers feel tired when they are not having opportunity to talk with their subordinates and to reduce their workload or whatever kind of grievances they are having, they can push off it by simply talking with their colleagues, their superior and their junior. That means some kind of informal structure must be existence to reduce their job stress. Then he said, yes, this is utilitarian. In case our employees are having low work profile, low educational profile, we need to centralize power or we need to give more authority to the top management. But in case our employees are more efficient, he introduced the provision of gangplank. He said, yes, we can allow or we can have a provision of parallel communication or communication between or among the workers who are operating at same level only when they inform about it or their communication or content of communication or the result of communication to their immediate superior. Let's understand it with an example. If D and H want to communicate with each other, earlier D had to communicate this to the C, then C would have contacted with the B and A, then A communicated with the F, G and L. It is distortion of communication. It is wastage of time and it did not help worker to reduce their job stress and to make timely decisions. Now he said, if D want to have a communication with the H, he must inform to his immediate supervisor, that is C, and H will also be introducing this problem or need for communication to the G. Only then after they can communicate, or even after communication, they will let no C and D about the matter what they have discussed, so that we can reduce the time of decision making, or we can avoid delay in decision making, at the same time reducing the possibility of unionization. So this is the provision which was introduced by him later on. He said scalar chain will make flow clear, will reduce role and goal conflict. Then we are coming to the next principle, that is called order. Order means there should be a particular place for everything, be it the man or it is the material, and everything must be at a particular place, be they are tool or be that is some employees. If we are visiting to a school for depositing fees, then fees clerk must be sitting at his job. If we want to meet the teacher of our child, then the teacher, if he is not having lecture, then he must be fined at staff home. If he is not there in staff home, it will cause wastage of time for the parents. If he is not in the lecture at the time of lecture, then it is also going to be unproductive for the organization. Now we are going to discuss about equity. Equity means fair treatment to the worker as far as possible, so that we can have a harmonious relationship existent at the work site. We can reduce all negative aspects that may affect the work performance of workers, or which may drain our talent, our spending, our investment towards the other organization. We should behave them with fairly. Stability of tenure, it means job security. Job security make any worker feel free-minded to show his potential, whatever he is having, to the fullest. Initiative, it means it is the manager's work to promote both things, feeling of initiative and team spirit. The workers must be motivated to show what they have new to be implemented in the organization. It means they must be allowed not only in the planning but also in the implementation part of the organization, so that their confidence can be boosted up. Team spirit means feeling of oneness, that we organization, we department, or we group workers are one and same. If anybody is not able to discharge his work responsibility, then our team will together fail to discharge its responsibility. We should have wholehearted and full cooperation towards attainment of our group objectives. All these are the principles of management, but my favorite principle is going to be the stability of tenure. You know what? We have failed working over 10-20 years that if we are having job security, we will have more job satisfaction. We are going to be more productive for the organization, not only for the organization, but for ourselves and society as a whole. The real creativity comes out when we are having job security. For being an employee, I like this principle, and I also like the principle of equity. But presently, we are conducting research on them, that how more effective we can make them. In our next lecture, we'll be discussing about the next topic of 12th curriculum, that is going to be the business environment. Dear student, you know, we need some motivation from your side. So if you find that we are really enriching your knowledge, I think you should subscribe, you should like our lectures, and you should also share them. Thank you. Have a good time. Stay safe. Stay home. Bye.